So when the investigations were not conducted by the applicant or for the application and for a, you know, and does not have the right to reference, that's one of the biggest things. So so it is a change that is not permitted under J, and it's not technically a new chemical entity. So what is the objective of the pathway? So obviously we need, the biggest thing is that we want to leverage the knowledge about the drug safety and efficacy. We want to avoid studies that are not statistically necessary, scientifically necessary, or duplicative. So basically FDA gave a pathway where they said that, no, you don't have to do everything. You don't have to reinvent the wheel, you know? Try to see what you can find in the public domain. But these have to be full studies, though. And I think Partha will talk a little more on that. And that, you know, use limited development data and at the same time try to, you know, provide enough information to the FDA that FDA is convinced that this is a viable drug. So alternative dosage forms, altered PK profile, enhance efficacy or safety due to better target or non-target. So what are the informations? Published literature, peer-reviewed articles, approved drug labeling, agency's finding of safety and effectiveness of an approved drug, other finding from other agency. This is very critical because a lot of time this is something that can be really, really dependent upon. Lot of these drugs are already in Europe. Like people come and say, we already have this drug in Europe and how do I bring it here? It can be leveraged very well. Referencing advisory committee summaries are acceptable. So first of all, you also have to talk about why referencing the, you know, depending on literature is justified for your product. So what are the three critical questions? Whenever, if you are thinking of a 505B2, you need to have three critical questions. Will the use of this new drug infringe on a valid patent or marketing exclusivity? If it is, you better be careful, be ready for lawsuits. What is the difference between the permitted and prohibited reliance? You know, so you can't look at the drugs and FDA, the summary basis, you know, of the approvals and use those for a 505B2. You cannot. You need to get real, complete literatures. Okay, other thing is, this is also interesting because I have faced this a lot. Is there an unintentional bioequivalence leading to poor bioavailability? Like people fail their bioequivalence and say, can I go 505B2? No, you can't, you know. Because if you have a generic drug and you failed you failed your bioequivalence study, that doesn't make it a 505B2 application. So define the differences. One of the biggest thing is to define the differences between the new drug and the previously approved drug. And as I said, the pro drugs are becoming very, very, you know, prominent these days. Other thing that we are seeing is change in formulation, and sometimes that's also with the quality, like using nanoparticles. So for the same drug, basically they are, you know, making it more efficacious by using nanoparticles, or like in case of others, like combining them with penetration enhancers for topical products, things like that. So I guess, you know, 505B2 has also opened this whole field of imagination. I know, you know, it's the sky is the limit. So, you know, imagine what you can do with the 505B2. Of course, there are the justify the reliance on the pre-existing literature, but support the differences with appropriate information, like toxicity due to different salts of a drug. So, you know, if you are trying to change from sildenafil citrate to sildenafil picrate, you have to be careful. You know, you don't want somebody to burst out in flames or something. So if you have a counter ion that has known toxicity, you know, that's where FDA may have issues. Or you may have to establish that based on the dosage that's being given, this is not an issue. Novel excipients, big one. In fact, we have seen a lot of situations where, companies faced a roadblock because they were trying novel excipients. And I know that IPEC has been collaborating and arguing with FDA a lot because they think that FDA is so conservative with excipients that, you know, it's kind of throttling innovation. They have wonderful excipients, wonderful coating material. People are afraid to use them because, FDA will ask so many questions. So the application needs to contain only that information needed to support the proposed modifications of the listed drugs. So the challenge here is, what is the appropriate data? You know, because sometimes you don't even want to data dump the FDA. That's the last thing you want to do, because they may find something and stop you from getting approved.